Sometimes people will refer to the culture of an organization as the personality of the organization. So if you're going to put two companies together to work together and they have two very different personalities, cultures, it would be just like two individuals having to do that. There's some things to work out if you're going to try to make that work. One of my clients uses a definition that I like a lot because he's kind of getting at the core of what culture is. He says, culture is what you do when nobody's watching. Isn't that a good one? And I think that what he's really talking about is that top one there, the heart and soul, the core of the culture that everything else comes from in that. But it's a very good definition. To make sure you do some really good due diligence on the cultures of the different organizations you're planning to bring together, not just the finances and the business strategies and the market share issues and some of those kinds of things that tend historically to be what people focus on when they're deciding who to put together in a mix for let's just focus on a merger in this case. The problem with doing that, leaving out the cultural due diligence, how similar are we, how different are we in terms of cultures, is that the primary reason from research that groups like McKinsey and various groups have done for years, if you look at the reasons that mergers or acquisitions fall apart, or even if they don't completely fall apart, don't ever produce the return that they were intended to produce, the vast majority of the reasons, many times 60, 70% of them, they'll say, are culture misfits. They never got it to jive. People were never willing to work together or able to work together in the way that they were supposed to. So if you ignore on the front end, which is what often happens, the culture issues, and choose your potential partner based on all the other reasons, you're at great risk of joining what ends up being the 50 or 60% of mergers that don't ever produce the results they were supposed to. One of the funniest stories that a colleague of mine who's a marriage counselor tells us about a couple who was in her office, and she gave them this survey to see the difference on these. And the woman was an artist and very much into the, obviously, the pictures, the imagery, and sort of the I've got an idea way of thinking or looking at things. And she was married to an engineer who was very much into the detailed factuals, you know, make lists kind of thinking. Of course, that's as far apart as you can get on the panel. They got the results, and the woman was looking at them, got very serious, and was listening to the explanation and everything. She looked up at her husband with a serious look on her face and said, "Now I understand why you alphabetize the cereal boxes in the pantry." You see the potential trouble here? He would get mad at her every morning because she wouldn't put the Raisin Bran back in the R slot. Now, my thinking pattern is like her, and let me tell you, if the Raisin Bran's back in the kitchen, you're doing well.